love her in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Friday the 13th, The Carnival, Chapter 17, Shoot the Clown. Maxie was leaning with her back against the counter of the game booth. From where she stood, she couldn't see what had happened at the Tilt-A-Whirl. She had heard the distant shouts and screams, but hey, shouts and screams were natural at a carnival. Then she saw the people running by the booth, all headed in the same direction. That worried her a little. Then a mother hustled past, going the other way, obviously leaving the fair. She was holding her young son firmly by the collar. The dark-haired boy was complaining. He didn't want to go home.
"The fair is really dangerous," the mother called to Maxie when she saw her looking. "Better get out while you can."
Dangerous, thought Maxie idly. Maybe this carnival was more fun than she thought. Instead of getting out, she turned lazily to watch Graham and Greg.
"Come on, come on, come on," Greg was urging himself, while slapping the wooden counter of the game booth with disgust.
Graham was chuckling, which told Maxie everything she needed to know about who was winning. They were playing the game where you shot a water pistol into the grinning mouth of a plastic clown. As long as you kept hitting the target, a balloon over the clown's head kept inflating. If the balloon burst, you won a prize. But as both Graham and Greg had quickly discovered, you had to win a whole lot of times before you had a chance at winning one of the big stuffed animals. She fingered the leather camera strap of Wendy's camera, which kept digging into her neck. Where was Wendy anyway?
"Guys," she said, "I don't want a stuffed animal, really. I mean it."
Ignoring Maxie, Graham said, "Again," to the carny who was operating the booth. He slapped down more money. He was paying for both him and Greg now. It was like a duel to the death. Bored, Maxie idly pulled the trigger of the gun in front of her. "Wanna play?" the carny asked her for the 100th time. He had a small head and a pimply face. "You can play for free," he offered. She knew that trick. She wasn't in the mood to be suckered. After all, she was already being suckered by her own dad. She shook her head. Then she saw him. Directly across from her, there was a man standing behind the booth, his eyes staring out the holes in the clown mask, staring right at her. At that moment, bang! The shot rang out. Chapter 18, I Dare You. Maxie jumped back, sure that she'd been shot. Then she realized Graham had just popped his clown's balloon. She looked back at the clown's face that grinned on the wall across from her. The dark eyes were blank. The man was gone. Or maybe she had only imagined him. What was wrong with her? She never thought she'd see the day when she acted like the big C word.
"Maxie, look!"
Graham was beaming at her. He was holding a giant black-eared Snoopy. Greg was standing beside him, empty-handed and glowering.
"How much did that cost you?"
Maxie drawled.
"Cost me?" Graham grinned ecstatically. "Are you kidding? I won it. It was free."
"Right," Maxie said. "He had a better gun," Greg grumbled. Maxie tossed her hair over her shoulder.
"You're both being ridiculous."
She took the Snoopy by the head, holding it in a careless stranglehold.
"Two guys duking it out with water pistols. That's really great. Come on, I want to find Wendy and KC and get out of here."
"What?" Graham looked stunned. "But we haven't been on any rides yet, and at midnight there's the fireworks."
"You stay," Maxie suggested.
"Maxie, wait," Greg said. He grabbed her hand. He was staring at her. There was something about the intensity in his face that made her squirm.
"What?" she asked.
"You have to go on one ride." She rolled her eyes.
"Oh, yeah? Who says?"
No, Graham said. "The boy is right.
One ride, that's only fair. No pun intended. Haha.
Greg ignored him, keeping his dark eyes on Maxie. He was looking mischievous all of a sudden.
Listen, I happen to know there's one ride that even you don't have the guts to go on.
Really? You mean Maxie gets scared sometimes? Graham asked. I find that hard to imagine.
Maxie looked down, watching her black boots scuff the dirt. She knew what Greg was trying to pull, but it was working all the same.
Don't be an ass. I'm not scared. I'm bored, so let's...
No, Maxie, Greg said. You're scared. I'm telling you. There's this one ride that's got you totally freaked.
Okay, wise ass, name it.
He gave the answer proudly.
The Tunnel of Love.
Maxie's head rocked back as she laughed. She again turned to go, only this time Greg said, I dare you.
Those were fighting words.
You jerk, she said. You're really pushing it, you know that?
I told you, you're scared.
Scared?
That's right. That's such a laugh. Huh.
Prove it.
Kids, Graham began, you know how mature you sound.
That was all Maxie needed, because that was her father's response to everything. When she was more mature, her father said she would understand why he had to work such long hours. When she was more mature, she would understand why Mommy and Daddy weren't getting along so well anymore. When she was more mature, she pushed the giant Snoopy doll back into Graham's arms.
Okay, she told Greg, let's go.
As she wandered miserably through the carnival, Wendy kept shoving handfuls of caramel corn into her small mouth. Her jaw ached from chewing the sticky candy. She couldn't even taste it anymore, and she certainly wasn't hungry. But still, she kept forcing in more and more junk food. Her round apple cheeks were stained with tears. Her mascara was all over the place. She knew she must look awful. That was one of the many curses of being homely, she thought miserably. When a girl like Maxie cried, she just looked prettier. The guys all lined up to comfort her. When Wendy cried, she usually ended up looking like death warmed over. She had reached one of the far corners of the carnival. She found herself facing a large black tent. Over the entrance hung a crescent-shaped sign, Sideshow. Next to the entrance, a midget was sitting on a high stool. He eyed her coldly as she approached. He held out his hand.
8 ride tickets.
What's inside? Wendy asked.
Freaks, the midget said matter-of-factly. Freaks of nature. Greatest freaks in the whole world. You'll see things that'll make your eyes pop out. Hey, the last kid who went in, he screamed for about 10 minutes. I guarantee you'll hurl or your money back.
Sounds like fun, Wendy said.
Freaks, she thought, tears welling. Freaks like herself. She pulled out the ride tickets. The midget held the tent flap open. Inside, she saw only darkness. She looked at him questioningly. He nodded.
Get in, he said.
Inside, the dark tent was lined with stalls. Each stall was hidden behind another flap and labeled with another sign. As usual, she wasn't wearing her glasses. She peered at the names. The Fat Lady, the Man with Two Heads, the Snake Lady, the Fire Eater, the Midget. She chose the Fat Lady. There was no sound from inside the stall as she approached. The thought of the Fat Lady sitting inside, just sitting and waiting for her to come and look at her, made Wendy's stomach lurch. She stepped closer.
Hello, she called. Excuse me, what do I do? Do I just come in?
No response. Wendy put her hand on the black canvas edge of the stall's curtain. She pulled the flap back and ducked her head inside. The first thing that struck her was the smell. Mixed with the sawdust smell were the powerful odors of sweat and blood. It made her want to gag, but she couldn't let herself do that. How would the Fat Lady feel if she took one look at her and puked? It was dark inside the stall. It took a moment for Wendy's eyes to adjust, and then she saw that it wasn't the Fat Lady's stall after all. They must have mixed up the signs, because sitting here, his back to her, was a large, muscle-bound man whose back was covered with the most amazing tattoos. Whoever it was, he had an amazing bod. He was built like a superhero in a comic book. He didn't appear to have a stitch of clothes on, so he was showing off all his tattoos. That midget was right. Wendy's eyes were bugging right out of her head. Maxie had always had her pick of boyfriends, but all her life, Wendy had longed for just one guy. One guy who would care about her, pay attention to her. Her eyes were locked on the man's naked body. Despite the gagging odor, she felt faint with desire. Then the tattooed man turned his head and stared at her. He was wearing a mask and holding a hacksaw. Chapter 19. The Show's Dead Tonight. Selena stepped out of the fortune-telling booth, closing the door partway behind her. She hadn't had a single customer since those teenage girls. She couldn't wait any longer. Turning to her right, she hurried through the empty fairgrounds. Many of the carnies, she now saw, had already left their posts. At the water slide, a young blonde boy was whizzing down the ramp all by himself, with no operator in sight. If Selena hadn't been in such a rush, she would have stopped and yelled at the boy to come down. It wasn't safe for him to ride alone. But Selena was in too much of a hurry. Besides, she was too far away to see that the whole ride was trembling. Her jaw clenched as she ran. Was it her imagination? Or were the two women who sold the glow-in-the-dark necklaces giving her funny looks, whispering, even laughing as she went by? She looked the other way, ignoring them, which meant she spotted Big Joe, who ran the skee-ball concession. He was smirking. She'd been nervous all night, but now her heart started to pound. Something was wrong, terribly wrong. She broke into a trot. About 20 yards up ahead, Peg O'Neill had a microphone in her hand and was trying, unsuccessfully, to attract customers for the old can-she-guess-your-age-or-weight game. Back in the clearing, Peg's van was parked right next to Molly's, where her mom was resting. Peg might know something. Selena hurried toward her. Peg got a funny look on her face when she saw her coming. The tall, broad-shouldered woman boomed into the mic. "Don't tell me you want to guess your age, Selena. Let's see. Are you 6 years old? No. Give that girl a Koopy doll." She chuckled into the mic, her laughter reverberating. Then she lowered the mic and said, "You're still here, haven't you heard? The show's dead tonight. Most of the guys have been knocking off early and going back to their vans to get a little shut-eye. We could all use it, too, after the way Fantana..." "Where is she?" Selena demanded. When Peg didn't answer right away, Selena grabbed one of the woman's muscular arms. "I said, where is she?"
"Who?"
"You know who, my mother."
"Now, Selena, how would I know where?"
"You know, I can tell. Just tell me." Peg sighed. She glanced around furtively, her face dark. She lowered her voice.
"Mr. Fantana thought it would be better if we told you after we closed tonight because..."
"Told me what?"
"Look, you know Fantana, sweetheart. He was probably afraid you'd run off or that he'd have to send one of the workers to drive you to..."
She stopped short, biting her lip. Selena felt like she was going to burst.
"Drive me where?" "Selena, girl, don't get scared, okay? But Helen seemed really worn out, so we took her to the local hospital just to check out what..."
"The hospital?"
"Yeah, see, the doctors say she's..."
Peggy grimaced.
"Look, kid, the doctors say she's in some kind of coma, okay? But I'm sure she'll be..."
"Hey, Selena, hold on. Selena, where are you going?" Selena raced for the exit, running flat out toward the two large revolving spotlights. She was so frenzied she could barely think. As a result, she almost ran straight into the fence. Mo, the clown who ran the entrance gate, was gone. The big metal gate was shut. In his place, a metal sign hung on the fence. Back in 10 minutes. Selena let out a stream of curse words so forceful one might almost have expected the gates to open in response. They didn't. She knew this trick. Sometimes when too many customers were leaving and no customers were arriving, Vince pulled Mo from the gate as a way of getting people to spend just a few more quarters before he let them go. She was about to scale the fence when a voice behind her barked, "What's going on?" She turned. A heavy-set, lonely-looking man with a balloon in his hand stood behind her, eyeing the closed gate. We're locked in," she said, panting for breath. "If you want to get out, don't bother waiting. I'm climbing over." The man grinned. "Locked in, eh? Well, they can't keep me in that easy. This carnival sucks. The games are rigged. I almost fell off the fucking Ferris wheel and broke my neck. Here, out of my way." Wanting to show off, the man pushed Selena aside and threw himself at the fence. He was planning to climb over so skillfully that the pretty young girl would be eternally impressed. He figured that would salvage something from this miserable, lonely evening. Selena was impressed, but not for the reason the man had hoped, because pop! That was the first thing Selena heard, the man's balloon popping. Then she was backing away from the fence in total horror, her hand covering her mouth. As hard as she tried, she couldn't turn her eyes away. The man was burning to a crisp. Chapter 20. The Tunnel of Love. Greg was leading the way to the Tunnel of Love. Maxie kept an eye out for Casey and Wendy, but there was no sign of them. She wasn't too worried. After all, she had the car keys. Mitch Deaver, who was working his way behind the row of game booths and keeping his eye on Maxie, wasn't too worried either. After all, he had the switchblade. The Tunnel of Love was housed in a big, dark, square booth and was decorated with fake ferns and big red hearts. The cars were boat-shaped, but ran on a track. Grinning broadly, Greg tapped Maxie on the back. "Here we go," he said with an attempt at a leer. Maxie just stood there. She was feeling angry and awkward and embarrassed, and two out of the three emotions felt very alien to her. Then she saw the looks on both men's faces. Of course, they were more embarrassed than she was. For the first time since they'd arrived at the carnival, she started to feel good. "So, Greg," she said brightly, "what are you waiting for? Come on, guy, let's go make nookie. Suck face. Come on, don't you want me?" Greg kept smiling, but his smile looked fake. And Graham's face was all twisted, as if someone were pinching his behind hard and he was trying not to let on. Greg paid the carny. Maxie squeezed into the car next to him, sitting even closer than she had to. "Don't wait up. We'll be a while," she told Graham with a big, cheery smile. But the teacher was paying his ride tickets as well. As she and Greg watched in disbelief, he climbed into the car right behind theirs. He smiled when he saw them looking at him and waved. What a jerk. At least he looked pretty ridiculous sitting all alone back there with his big Snoopy doll. "That guy can't leave us alone for a minute," Greg muttered. "Just ignore him," she told him as their car jerked forward. At the entrance to the tunnel hung a flap of black rubber. The car pushed through the flap, disappearing into the darkness. "Don't look back," she commanded Greg. She smiled as Greg turned and faced straight forward. "Greg," she said, "you're supposed to look at me, silly." "What? Oh yeah, sorry." As it turned out, the Tunnel of Love wasn't really a tunnel. It was a large, dark room decorated with fake palms. A staticky soundtrack played Hawaiian ukulele love songs over the loudspeakers, while five or six cars meandered slowly around the track. There were new cars coming in and old cars leaving all the time. On the far side of the shed, there was one other couple, groping wildly as their car wound behind a large strand of plastic ferns. pretty sexy spot, huh? Maxie asked in her sexiest voice. Greg swallowed loudly.
Yeah?
She placed one hand gently against his damp neck.
So, what are you so nervous about?
I'm not nervous.
You look nervous.
Well, I'm not.
I thought you said I was too scared to come in here.
Maxie, I was so mad at that pawn scum back there that I lost my head. I'm sorry, this was a crazy idea. You don't want to be here, I know that.
What are you saying? That it's crazy to go through the tunnel of love with little old me?
Greg looked pained. His eyes went black.
Maxie, he murmured, don't joke with me. I can't take it. You know how I feel. I've never felt anything like this before in my entire life. I swear to you, I feel like I'm bursting every time I look at you.
He lowered his head, the words tumbling out.
I know I made a fool of myself playing that game with Mr. Newton, but I can't help it. The thought of some creepy old guy putting the moves on you just makes me go berserk.
Greg, she began, but she didn't go on. She was strangely touched.
Maxie, I know you think I'm crazy pursuing you like this, but I feel like I know you, really know you. Know what I mean?
I don't know. Maybe it's the orphan thing. I know what it's like to feel alone, okay? And even though you always have friends around, I can tell you feel that too.
She started to turn away, mumbling.
You don't know what I feel.
But he grabbed her hand.
I do know. I do know. I see how you look.
How I look?
Maxie, whenever I see you, you've got the most amazing look on your face. Like you're really sad and bored and like you've seen everything and you're really lonely. All at the same time. And it just makes me want to be the one to cheer you up. I can make you smile, Maxie. I promise you, I can make you smile.
Maxie was already smiling.
You've got your soundtrack, she observed softly.
Huh?
He was shaking now. He was so nervous.
Corny music, just like in the movies?
Oh, yeah.
She could sense movement in the car behind them, Graham's car, but she didn't turn to look. Not even when she heard a strange gulping sound, like he was swallowing something the wrong way. She kept her amber eyes firmly fastened on Greg. She reached out her long arms. She saw his eyes widen with shock as she pulled his head towards hers. Thanks to the darkness, their foreheads bumped hard. She figured she'd pay for this kiss with a serious headache later. Not to mention how she'd pay the next time she tried to get out of going on a date with Greg. But that was later, and this was now. Her lips found his as she kissed him fiercely. She clung to him with all of her might. It was an endless kiss, and the whole time she and Greg were making out, she could feel that they were being watched, could feel Graham's eyes boring into her from behind. Let him watch, she told herself. He could make out with his Snoopy doll for all she cared. Actually, in the car behind them, Graham now lay with his head straight back and his mouth wide open, staring wide-eyed at the fake stars that were pasted to the roof of the Tunnel of Love. His arms hung limply around the Snoopy doll. His blood was quickly and brightly staining the dog's white fur. Mitch had already climbed out of Graham's car. He was making his way through the fake ferns towards Maxie. Maxie finally let go of Greg. He just sat there, his jaw hanging down, his eyes glassy in the darkness.
Wow, he breathed. Then he threw his hands up in the air and whooped joyously.
Thank you, God, he yelled.
Maxie laughed.
Don't tell me you've never been kissed before.
Not like that, he said with a huge grin.
Not by someone I...
He couldn't speak. This whole moment was a great distraction for Mitch, as he made his way silently towards their car. And the strange thing was, neither could she. She couldn't speak at all. Suddenly, she was feeling it. The thing everyone always talked about. Her heart was fluttering, her blood pounded in her head so hard it roared in her ears. The guy had touched her soul. This was crazy. She was a goner.
And for who? For Greg Dillon? She needed to hold him. Come here, you, she said, and she reached for him. But as they went back into another kiss, Maxie suddenly saw her father. It was as if a trap door opened in her stomach, and all the good feelings fell right out. Right as Mitch, under the power of Jason, was mere inches away. It was him, all right. He was riding three cars ahead. She spotted her dad just as his car was pushing through the doors that led back outside. But she saw him distinctly. Bev, too, with her mane of long red hair like a horse's tail. Even as they rode out of the room, the older couple stayed locked in an embrace, no less passionate than the one Maxie had just given Greg. Maxie shoved Greg back hard, suddenly furious, almost slamming him into the hiding Mitch. She sat up straight. I'll be right back. She threw a leg out of the car. Hey, where are you going? Maxie, be careful. But even though Greg grabbed at her hand and then at her leg, she managed to clamber quickly out of the moving car. She was sort of surprised that Greg didn't shout for her to come back. The truth was, he tried. But that was the moment that Mitch slit his throat. Chapter 21, The Scrambler. Maxie tripped as she was coming out the door of the Tunnel of Love. She banged her shin against a pile of painted rocks that formed the ride's foundation. She fell hard. When she got up, she was cursing, and she cursed even louder when she saw she had ripped a big hole in the knee of her pants. She had also banged Wendy's camera underneath her as she fell. Probably broken it, too, the way the night was going. It was all her father's fault. Every last bit of it. When she got up, she ran around to the front of the ride. She was in time to see her father and Bev strolling off hand in hand into the darkness. Cursing and limping, Maxie followed. When she finally caught up to them, Dad and Bev were getting on another ride, the Scrambler. Maxie started to run, the camera banging against her chest. The Carney ride operator was already heading for his control booth, and she didn't have any ride tickets anyways, so she just ran past him before he could see her and climbed into one of the cars. Tunnel of Love or no Tunnel of Love, Dad and Bev were still smooching up a storm. Maxie wanted to scream. The only good thing about their kissing was that it meant they didn't see her. Excellent. She'd surprise them, and she'd take some candid snapshots to show Mom, assuming the camera wasn't broken. Maxie's mother seemed to be the only one in Holloway who didn't believe the rumors about her father's affair. Or at least so, she claimed. Well, thanks to these photos, she'd have to face what was going on once and for all, like it or not. The Scrambler was large and creepy-looking, shaped sort of like a giant spider with eight legs. Hanging from the bottom of each leg was a different colored car. Maxie was in the red car, her father and Bev were in the blue car. Soon the ride picked up speed and all eight cars crisscrossed. Dad and Bev were screaming now, shouting like happy schoolchildren, as the Scrambler's cars careened faster and faster. They stopped screaming when they saw Maxie. She waved to them and shouted the meanest thing she could think of. It didn't matter. With the grinding of the Scrambler's gears, the rushing speed of the cars, and the blaring music of the ride, every word she screamed was drowned out. At least she could enjoy the shocked look on their faces. Good, 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 she thought bitterly. She slipped the annoying leather strap off her neck and started snapping pictures as fast as she could rewind. But her car was moving so fast now she doubted she was getting anything except blur. The Scrambler was a scary ride. Sometimes it looked like the cars were going to smash into each other. Other times it seemed certain the cars would break free and crash into the tall barbed wire fence that bordered the fairgrounds. Her dad seemed to have regained his composure. The next time their cars aimed right at each other, he took a hand off the safety bar and raised it in greeting. He was trying to smile, trying to act like this was just the most natural thing in the world, being caught cheating by your only daughter. Let him die, Maxie prayed. Let him die right now. Criss-cross, criss-cross. The cars were whizzing faster.
The whine of the ride's gears was rising in pitch, higher and higher, till the noise was screeching in Maxie's ears. All at once, Maxie, who couldn't remember the last time she'd been scared on a ride, felt the first pangs of fear, because the cars were coming closer together each time they crossed. And now when her car swung out toward the fence, she could almost touch the wire mesh. Off to her left, two empty cars smacked together so hard that sparks and splinters flew in all directions. There was no doubt left. The ride was totally out of control. Maxie twisted around in her seat, looking toward the Carney's booth. No ride operator in sight. She screamed anyway. Bev and her father were yelling too, yelling for help probably. Maxie couldn't hear a thing. It just looked like Dad and Bev had their mouths wide open as her father's car rushed right at the fence. And this time the car didn't stop inches from the wire mesh. This time the car crashed right into it. Maxie started yelling again, yelling with all of her might. Because as the red and blue cars crisscrossed once more, she saw that her father was slumped over the safety bar. So was Bev. Her dad's arm was hanging over the side of the car too, so that when the two cars smashed into each other, his arm acted as a shock absorber for the blow. Mixed into the giant smashing noise, Maxie heard the tiny crunching sounds as her father's arm was crushed. Then her own car, shaking wildly in all the wrong directions, flew off again and she couldn't see her father anymore. Except in her mind's eye, where she could vividly picture the wire mesh of burn marks she had seen across her father's face. And now she was screaming as she had never screamed before, not just with utter horror, but also with terrible guilt. She had wished her father dead, and it had happened. She screamed some more, and then so did everybody on the ride. Her car was careening toward the fence again, but this time she ducked down fast so that only the car and no part of her body banged into the metal. There was a cascade of sparks, tiny cuts in the darkness. She was still alive. She wished she wasn't, because now she had to watch helplessly as her father's car zoomed back toward the fence. This time the ride jammed Dad and Bev against the metal, and the car stuck there, holding them in place in a cloudburst of sparks and smoke. Maxie couldn't look anymore. The ride had stopped. An awful, acrid burning smell filled her nostrils. She climbed out, jumped down, and ran toward her father as best she could on unsteady legs. Before she was halfway there, the smoke cleared enough for her to see her dad and the woman clearly. What was left of them. Caught between car and fence, their bodies were being pushed through the hot wire links like hamburger meat. Their clothes were burning right off of them. Their blood was spattering everywhere like grease from a hot skillet. Maxie staggered back a few steps, fell. The camera dropped. There was another shower of sparks from the fence, bursting suddenly like fireworks. The fireworks felt like they were exploding inside of her own brain. She turned and ran toward the operator control booth. Inside, the Carney was slumped over the controls. She couldn't speak. She just grabbed him and yanked him upright. The man fell back again as soon as she let him go. Her hands were slick with the Carney's blood. Then she saw the red slash marks in the man's t-shirt. Many of the letters in the embossed words, Fantana's Funhouse, had been cut out, leaving the message, Fate. She was too stunned and horrified to scream. She couldn't breathe. Her heart had frozen. Then she turned around. A man in a white mask stood right behind her. He was about to plunge a knife into her chest. Chapter 22, The Strong Man. The man held the knife high above Maxie as he eyed her through his mask. She could feel his awful, leering eyes undressing her. He began to chuckle. He reached out with a tattooed hand, wiggling his forefinger like a snake. She shrank back so hard she smacked her head against the edge of the wooden control booth. The man's tattooed hand kept coming. It stroked her cheek. She turned her face away as hard as she could, but the man cupped her face with his hand, squeezing her cheeks together harshly so that she made a fish face. He laughed harder. Then the man's tattooed hand let go of her and began traveling down. With pointed finger, he traced a line straight down her chest, as if marking the spot he would cut her. She shoved the hand away and tried to run, but the man pressed forward, pinning her against the booth with his body. He was taller than she was. He lowered his head towards hers, bringing the mask up to her face. At least the white mask kept his lips from touching hers, but his eyes were on her, those leering eyes. She felt his hot breath on her skin. And then he dropped the knife, letting it clatter to the floor, and grabbed her lithe body with both hands. She spat right into the eye holes of the mask. The man's head jerked back, his hands instinctively flying up to his eyes. And in that same moment, Maxie shoved the man with all of her might. She was no match for him, but the surprise was just enough to knock him slightly off balance. And when he stepped back, he stepped on the foot of the fallen ride operator. The man in the mask fell, crashing backward into the booth. Maxie didn't stick around to see what happened after that. She was running flat out through the deserted fairgrounds, screaming for help. If she had had even a split second to think about it, she would have realized the irony of the name she screamed for. She was screaming, "Daddy!" She turned the next corner and saw, with wild relief, that she had found people. They were standing by the strong man's booth. It was that short, fat man she had seen at the fortune teller's. He was yelling at the last few customers who were filing past him. "I'm telling you, the rides are safe. Come back here," he swore. "You can't get out. I've got the gate locked. You can't get out unless I..." Maxie had started screaming again. She was forcing the sound out of her mouth so hard, she felt as if she were ripping out her vocal cords. That was all the customers needed. They started running for the exit. The man turned and glared at Maxie in disbelief, his tiny red eyes burning with anger. "Crazy man killing the rides. My dad..." Maxie couldn't get the words out. She was shaking all over with shock, pain, fear, and grief. The man grabbed her shoulders and shook her even harder. "What's the matter with you?" he yelled. "Why would you scare up my customers like that? Are you insane? You want to make me more broke than I already am?" Maxie was crying now. The man slapped her hard, as if that would snap her out of it. "I'm ruined!" he shrieked at her. "You understand me, girl? I am ruined!" Maxie stopped yelling. She stared at him in a daze. It was as if she were dead inside. She watched the man helplessly. There was a brutal scowl on his face as he raised his open palm to slap her again. Then, just a few yards away, a bell rang so loudly that they both turned. It was the bell from the strongman game. For a quarter, you walloped a little metal scale with a huge mallet. You tried to make the metal ball shoot all the way up and hit the bell. If you rang the bell, you won a stuffed animal. That's why Vince Fantana was so surprised to hear that bell ring so loud and clear. You had to be incredibly strong to ring the bell. Almost all the customers who played the game just lost their quarter. The man who had rung the bell had his back to them. He hefted the huge mallet once more, raising the wooden hammer high overhead. Then he turned and swung. Okay, this has been chapters 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, and 22 of Friday the 13th, The Carnival by Eric Morse. You know, tonight was pretty much action all the way through. You'll notice in uploads whenever I, because I always do at least 30 to 35 pages per upload on these young adult novels. And the reason, like yesterday's upload was around 51 minutes and this one is only 40 minutes, is because when it's all action, the narration goes a lot faster. When there's a lot of talking and story buildup and stuff, it tends to go a little bit slower. So that's why it was about, this video was 10 minutes shorter than yesterday's, even though it was the same amount of pages. By the way, this was the penultimate upload for this book, which means the next upload will be the conclusion of Friday the 13th, The Carnival. And characters have dropped like flies. We've lost Casey. It was implied we lost Wendy, but we haven't got any confirmation on that yet. But, you know, he was there with the hacksaw. She hasn't been seen since then, but he's moved on to kill other people. Maxie got her wish, and her dad died, and I thought that was horrible. Because I think we've all had moments like that where I hate you, Dad or Mom, you know, but you don't really mean it. And she definitely didn't really want to see her dad die, but she had to sit there and see it nonetheless. But we've lost Greg now. We've lost the creepy teacher, which I don't really care about the teacher, but I am upset that we lost Greg. I thought he was going to have, like, these lucky moments throughout the book, like he did on the roller coaster, where he almost met his death, but was able to luck out at the last second without even realizing he was in danger. I really thought it was going to go that way, and he was going to be the final boy of the story, since Maxie is apparently the final girl. I'm not really sympathetic to Maxie until tonight's upload. And I think that the moment she had with Greg really made her reflect on her true self. And I think all the shallow stuff she's been doing is just an act she puts out to deal with her own inner battles. But I think she's a very well fleshed out character that has a lot more depth and cares a lot more than she puts on. So I am rooting for her at this point. I wasn't rooting at her before tonight's upload. I'm rooting for her now. But yeah, our kill count is off the charts tonight. I mean, so many people died. And it looks like they're going to keep dropping. I mean, we just ended tonight's upload with a giant mallet being swung at Mr. Fantana and Maxie. So whenever we pick up in the next upload with the conclusion, who's going to be left standing at the end of this? You know, I'm really looking forward to it, and I hope you guys are too. So please, in the comment section, let me know what you think of the book so far, what your predictions are for the conclusion, and we can discuss it in the comments, and then we can see if we were right or not whenever we get the conclusion to this book very soon, probably tomorrow. Also, guys, I want you to check the community section right now. We have a contest going on. The winner, what I'm going to do is I ask a question. Out of all the correct answers, I'm going to do a drawing. Whoever I draw is going to win an official 80 Slasher Librarian coffee mug. They'll get to pick the design and the color of the mug. So go to the channel page here on YouTube, click on the community tab, and you'll be able to see how to enter and everything right there. That'll be where the question is. Also, guys, we're getting really close to 5,000 subscribers. Once we hit 5,000 subscribers, we're going to have a mega contest giveaway. It's going to be big. There's going to be 5 winners to represent each 1,000 subscribers that we have. So yeah, 5 big winners when we hit 5,000 subscribers here on the channel. Right now, we only need about 70 more subscribers and we hit it. So spread the word, hit social media, Twitter, Facebook, Reddit, wherever. Let your friends and family know about the channel. Have them come subscribe. When we hit 5,000, big giveaway going on. And with 5 winners, your chances are great, guys. And also, don't forget to check out the 80 Slasher Librarian official merch store over at Teespring. Check the description below for a link to the store and use the promo code 10OFF. That's 10 off. Use that promo code at checkout for 10% off every purchase forever on this channel. On the channel store. Guys, it would really help the channel out. Plus, you're going to get something that helps you walk around in slasher style. Until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying, thanks for listening, and
Please support the channel by going to that store, guys. It'll help me get more books to read to you guys in the future. I've been buying them out of pocket, and they are very expensive, so I'd really appreciate the help. And also, if you go there, you better get something, because something I've heard about the website is...
it's got a death curse!
I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Ouch, 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 ouch. Stop it! Come on, stop it. Back. Bad mask. Hey! This is William Patterson, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris, and you are listening to 80s Slasher Librarians narration of my book, Friday the 13th, Carnival. Enjoy.